Now I want to discuss lactones, lactams, and cyclization reactions. So guys, it turns out that esters and amides can be made to form rings, okay? And when you have a cyclic ester or a cyclic amide, these molecules have their own names that are very prevalent in organic chemistry and that you should be aware of, okay? So a cyclic, I didn't spell it, there we go. Okay, whoa. So a cyclic ester is called a lactone, okay? A cyclic amide is called a lactam, okay? And the way that you get these is through the cyclization of either hydroxycarboxylic acids. So here I have an example here. Okay, so a hydroxy group on a carboxylic acid, or amino carboxylic acids, as I have here. Okay, now these molecules are going to form rings spontaneously when the rings can be 5 and 6 membered. Why? Because these are very stable rings. So, for example, here I have delta hydroxyvaleric acid. Okay, notice that when delta hydroxyvaleric acid cyclizes, what happens is that this O comes in, right, attacks the carbonyl, you get a tetrahedral intermediate, but eventually you kick out this OH, okay? So this would just be basically an esterification reaction, okay? Notice that the size of your ring is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and that's exactly what you would expect. So we get a 6-membered ring, okay? These equilibrium arrows that I drew are purposeful. I showed that they're pretty much in perfect equilibrium because if you can make a 5 or 6-membered lactone, that's definitely gonna wanna be, you know, it's gonna form in equilibrium, okay? In fact, that actually happens in our bodies. In our bodies, sugars are forming lactones all the time. Sugars can form 6-membered rings and they form lactones all the time in your body, okay? So now let's go on to lactams, okay? Lactams, same idea. Nitrogen could come in, do a nucleophilic acyl substitution. Eventually, you kick out the OH, and you could make a form of ring. Now, this one, this equilibrium arrow, is also purposeful because notice that I'm making the ring smaller than 5 members. In this case, I'm making a 4-membered ring. That is much, much less stable. In fact, there's a possibility that this doesn't happen on its own at all because of the fact that it's just so strained that it would prefer to exist as a chain. It might take some extra help, some extra reagents to make it into a 4-membered ring. Okay, makes sense so far? So 5 and 6 is good. Anything less than that is bad. Also, anything bigger than that, also not very favored. Okay, now we get into naming. So how do we name these guys? Well, it turns out that the functional group of a lactone or lactam can also be specifically named by the size of the ring. But instead of saying it's a 6-carbon lactone or whatever, what we do is we use the Greek symbols from where the original substituent would have been. So for an alcohol, for to make this lactone here, 6-membered ring, that means that my alcohol would have had to be on the alpha, beta, gamma, delta carbon, okay? And since my alcohol was originally on the delta carbon, this would be called a delta lactone, okay? Now, if you're ever confused about what type of lactone or lactam you have, you could always just start counting from scratch. You could just say the carbon next to the carbonyl is my alpha, and then you can just go from there. Just remember that you only count carbons. So it's alpha, beta, gamma, delta, we're done. So this is a delta lactone. Same thing with lactams, exactly the same, except that now, since this one's smaller, this is what we would call a beta-lactam, okay? Now, not to bore you, but beta-lactams are really important, guys, because beta-lactams are found in pharmaceuticals all the time, in antibiotics, okay? So beta-lactams are extremely good at disrupting the cell membranes of bacteria, okay? So that's why they work really well in your body. That's what penicillin is. It's a beta-lactam, all right? So that is really all you need to know in terms of the general features of lactones and lactams. So why don't you guys go ahead and try to cyclize this molecule, see what you get, and see if you can generalize what the functional group is. I don't need you to name it, because that's way beyond the scope of this course. You don't need to name the exact molecule, but tell me what type of functional group it is and the Greek letter in front of it. So do that now.